Bas Nieuwhof and Rob Moore here again of InThatDay.net. We just have got together again on a Sabbath afternoon having a discussion, and we've been considering the minor prophets. Given all the circumstances that we see taking place in the world today, we were wondering what we learn from the minor prophets about the coming redemption of the people of Yahweh, and whether we learn some lessons that can be applied to what we see around us today. So we believe that there is quite a lot to be said by the minor prophets as relating to circumstances today that we find ourselves in. And as you all would agree, I'm sure things seem to be accelerating in terms of the collapse of the current state of order as we all know it in countries around the globe. And so we just want to hear from our Father in heaven and what is written in his word, and see if we can gain lessons from the minor prophets. So to begin with, we're just going to have a little brief overview of the context of the content of all the minor prophets, what they have to say, summarized very succinctly. And then we're going to work through a series of discussions, examining them all, and see what lessons each one offer up to us today in terms of exhortation, in terms of things to watch. Because today, in the last days, Yeshua told us that we must just watch. That's the most important thing. Watch and see and compare to his word, and stay strong in the faith. So we trust this will be a blessing to you. So we'll start with having a look at a brief overview of what the minor prophets, their theme, basically, what they have to say as a collection of prophets to us today.
Yeah. So as we study anything in the scripture, we must study it in relation to the precept that's given to us in Ecclesiastes chapter 1. In verse 9, which states, "What has been will be again, what has been done will be done again. There is nothing new under the sun. If there is anything of which one can say, 'Look, this is something new,'" in other words, there's nothing new, and what happens in the past will happen again. Now, for example, if you listen to men today, they will deny, particularly the scientists, that there was ever a flood. So if you deny that there was ever a flood, right, which was a judgment, then of course, if you go to 2 Peter, you don't have to worry what 2 Peter says. But 2 Peter, in chapter 3, says, in verse 8, "But they deliberately forgot," that is these men, "that long ago, by Elohim's word, the heavens existed, and the earth was formed out of water and by water. By these waters also the world of that time was deluged and destroyed. By the same word, the present heavens and earth are reserved for fire, being kept for the day of judgment and destruction of ungodly men." So if you say, well, you know, the first flood in Noah's day never existed,
it was a myth, yeah.
It was a myth. Mm. Then therefore, you know, you can deny 2 Peter that there is any judgment coming. Yeah. Now, all through those minor prophets, and I'm going to just give you, as you say, succinct, the actual theme of the books is, for example, the book of Amos is the judgment on Israel and its restoration. The book of Obadiah is the judgment of Esau. And then the book of Jonah is the mercy for the repenting Gentiles. Micah, judgment on the leaders of Israel, Jerusalem, and the prophets. And then we go to Nahum, the judgment of the Assyrian and the fall of Nineveh. The book of Habakkuk, the punishment of Elohim's people, by the Chaldean, and Zephaniah, the day of Yahweh, national and international judgment, and only a remnant will survive and return. Then the book of Haggai, the building of the house of Yahweh, and Zechariah, the millennial kingdom, in which this millennial temple is going to be built. Which gives us, of course, the messianic passages, and then his coming in glory, and the building of the house, and his reign. So that's basically the theme of these various books.
So what we look into, if that being the themes, do we see those themes unfolding today, is what we are really considering, because of the injunction in Ecclesiastes that what has happened before will happen again, and there's nothing new under the sun. So what happened to historical Israel, its release from slavery, and then its redemption, its national king, establishment of a nation with a king, then its judgment because of its going astray, and then its scattering into the world as a judgment, and becoming not a people, and so on. All these things that we've been considering, do we find similar lessons to be learned in the minor prophets, just as you've been reading out the themes? And just as you've already said, some of these themes are really pointing to what we understand as the last day's narrative. It's quite clear that they definitely... and I think each one of these prophets end with the injunction towards Israel in the last days.
Correct.
Towards the redemption of Yahweh. When I'm talking Israel, I'm talking the Israel of Yahweh. I'm not talking about Israel of the natural. I'm talking about the redeemed Israel who are redeemed by the blood of Yeshua and following his commandments. So, I mean, there's a lot of things. The In That Day website really was born about 15 years ago. I started off really under the conviction when we started really burdened to understand the law of Moses as a template for the last day's redemption. And the whole narrative that really got me excited was the narrative of Joseph and the famine and the great restoration of the 12 tribes of the house, the redemption of the body of Israel, the Israel of Yahweh, as a picture for what would happen in the last days. And so likewise, we're looking at the minor prophets in the same vein. What happened historically? And do we see that kind of event, the themes, not exactly life for life, but the principles, precepts of the principles of what was happening actually unfolding again today, which can make give us a lot of insight and understanding to the situation that we're in? And for me, it's remarkable how the scriptures are able to do this. Yahweh does this because it's a living word. This is the point about the scriptures being living word, because they speak to us even today as they spoke to the ancestors way back. And for the principle that Yahweh says, I've known the end from the beginning, and what has happened before is going to happen again.
Yeah, and then Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, all these things which happened to them, right, are written down
For our admonition,
on which has come the end of the age.
Yeah, for a specific reason, so that we will learn the lessons and not reproduce the failures, or take the warnings thereof when these situations come again.
Yeah, so therefore, in this message of all these minor prophets is a message of preparation and awareness.
Yeah, and I think... having come out of evangelical Christendom denominationally, being familiar with what is taught there in terms of Christian eschatology, evangelical eschatology, this is one thing that I find that has been neglected badly, and probably why you have ended up with dominionist theology and all these kinds of different eschatologies, because they have totally overlooked what has been, or let's say, misunderstood much of what is the focus of the minor prophets, because they didn't understand the history of ancient Israel. They didn't look back and see what actually happened to establish the context, and then take this principle of Ecclesiastes that this will happen again in the future, because when we see things unfolding, Yahweh says it's all happened before, so you can learn. It's not something that's foreign, that's strange. Just as Joseph gathered his house, so it's going to happen in the last days. Just as the Exodus happened with Moses, so it's going to happen in the last days. And so here we're talking about, the minor prophets talking about the judgment of an Israel that went into exile through punishment, through rebellion against Yahweh. So, because in the end, I think the issue is in Moses. He says, I'm not talking just to you, but I'm talking to those who are not standing with us here today.
Which is exactly what Paul repeats in 1 Corinthians chapter 10.
Yeah. And then also you get this confession that the last generation, unless you make this confession of repentance, I think it's in Deuteronomy or Leviticus 23 or 26, until you confess that Yahweh was just in what he did, and you acknowledge the rebellion of your fathers and your iniquity of the fathers and your own iniquity, because we're in the subsequent state, that we are also, as when you look at the world, the scattering of Israel is in effect still yet in rebellion against Yahweh in many of the lessons that we're learning from the minor prophets. For example, in Amos, when Amos condemns Israel for being totally carried away to wealth and riches and exploiting the poor, look at the Western world as it is today. Look what's happening with the bankers taking all the money and the rich getting extremely rich and the middle class is disappearing and the poor and the suffering. In every country that you can see where Israel, ancient Israel would have been scattered today, the economics is completely failing for the ordinary person, but certain people are getting very, very wealthy. So anyway, we'll leave that for aside. But let's consider Amos then.
Yeah, so before we sort of get into this, we have to go back right to the beginning. Why are all these minor prophets or the other prophets prophesying about all this? Yahweh doesn't do anything unless he reveals it to his prophets, right? Because at the beginning, it starts already with Cain and Abel. Cain wanted to serve Yahweh the way he wanted to do it, and he did it in a way which was to Yahweh unacceptable. He was the slayer of his brother, he killed him, so he was the first murderer on earth, right? But then Yahweh set a mark upon Cain, because Cain says, you know, they're going to... No, he says, if anybody touches you, I will avenge you seven times. And you can see that the line of Cain is the line of evil. It's like Cain is in charge of evil. You know, with Cain, and then you later on, you come to Jacob and Esau, you know? And all through these minor prophets, almost without exception, you get this judgment over Esau, because it is the spiritual fight between the descendants of Jacob, in other words, biblical or scriptural Israel, on the one side, and Esau, or the forces thereof, on the other. And today, we can recognize exactly who these forces, or who Edom is, or Esau is today, because Esau's descendants are still very much alive. So you could sum it up by saying, you've got the Israel of Yahweh on the one hand, right, which Satan must defeat. Because if he doesn't defeat it, then Jacob and its Messiah will defeat him. But we know from the scriptures that Messiah is not going to come unless scriptural Jacob is going to cry out and say, blessed is he who comes in the name of Yahweh. Because he says, I will not come again, in the book of Matthew, until you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of Yahweh. So if there is no people, and we can see that this has already happened right in the beginning. Right in the beginning, we can see, for example, in the time of Adam and Eve, you know, how at the end, before the flood, everybody did and was absolutely evil. So if Satan could have wiped out this whole lot there and then, the game would have been over. But Yahweh saved Noah and his family. And then, for example, if you come to King David, you see that King David, his family is being taken by the Amalekites, you know? Finally, he wins them back, right? But the deal was, if we can, because Satan knows exactly most things about Yahweh's plan, not all things, because what he didn't know about David's wives, he thought, well, if I get these wives, kill all that off, then there can no seed come out of David. But what he didn't know was that the seed would come via Bathsheba rather than the wives that he... Okay, David got them back and everything was fine in the end. We can see, for example, you know, in the congregation of believing Jacob, right? Satan is absolutely trying to kill this off, right? We see it in the physical people of Israel, you know. Throughout the ages, they're being persecuted and tried to be killed off. So this is a whole fight between the spirit, between the powers of light, as the Sadducees say in the Dead Sea Scrolls, and the powers of evil, you know. And Jacob represents the righteous, believing Jacob, the righteous of Yahweh, and the sons of darkness is Esau. Everything which is against biblical Jacob is Esau. So if you see forces that want to eliminate Jacob, they are Esau at work.
And the word of Yahweh, yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. So that's the greater narrative, is this because Satan has dominion over the earth at this time. And I thought about this, you know, Yeshua said, and it's translated in our scriptures, you know, my kingdom is not of this world. You see it being, you're being quoted all the time, my kingdom is not of this world. But if we go back to that, actually, I don't believe that's a correct translation.
No, it says, my kingdom is not of this age.
Yes, correct. So, my kingdom is not of this age.
Correct.
Because if it was, the translation was correct, that my kingdom is not of this world, then you would never have, I think that translation almost facilitates things and undergirds eschatological doctrines like the pre-tribulation rapture.
Yeah, it's been put there by amillennialists.
Yeah.
Who say there is no millennium, so therefore it has to be the end of the world.
Yeah.
You know? Because there's, you know, therefore, they also say his kingdom is not of this world. He has a heavenly kingdom,
yeah,
and that's where they're
so
going.
It gives all the church their eschatology. Excellent. About pre-tribulation, yep, rapture, whatever, and that there's no millennial reign, as we know. There's no physical. We're still in the physical, but we live in his sight 1,000 years because we're in the Garden of Eden restored. So it's my kingdom is not of this age, he said. So we know, because of the sabbatical, the eschatology of this, the narrative of the Sabbath, is that that's talking about a day of rest, a 1,000-year millennial reign where Jacob will rest, be at rest with his Redeemer.
Yep.
And but he said on another thing, my kingdom is within you.
Mm-hmm.
So redeemed Israel is redeemed because the kingdom is within us, and he goes with us wherever we go, no matter where that wandering is. And yeah, I'll get getting more into this in terms of the circumcision of the heart, because the issue is that in the law, Yahweh was always interested in the circumcision of the heart rather than the flesh. The heart being, he always wanted Israel to be ethically, in a voluntary way, not an enforced manner, but ethically in line with his precepts and commandments.
Absolutely.
So the ethics... is something that we still deal with, and particularly like the major minor prophet, the minor prophets here, because they talk about the rebellion of Israel. So they've gone away from the ethics, they've gone away from the commandments of Yahweh.
Mm-hmm.
Yeshua comes to correct that and to teach about how these commandments, it's still the circumcision of the heart that is interested. In the last days, we have this greater narrative where there will be Israel, that a remnant of the physical will be redeemed, together with those who are called out from among the Gentiles, who accept Yeshua by faith and then take his ethics and put the and live them according to the circumcision of the heart. That's the kingdom of Yahweh within you.
Yeah, so you could also say, if you live in accordance with the precepts, laws, and decrees of Yahweh, thereby you love Yeshua, because whoever loves me keeps those commandments,
yes,
then you are walking and then you are filled with the Spirit.
Yes, all right. So that's evidence of being filled in the, with the Spirit.
Exactly.
So, but that's a remnant of Jacob. And he talks about the remnant shall return. Those that are remnant will be those who carry the ethics, his biblical ways, because it's a walk, how they walk, ethically how they walk, not religiously how they walk, but ethically how they walk. And it's not, and it's a small part. It's Amos talks about that, how small it's going to be.
Oh, yes.
But
it's like the bone and a couple of bones taken out of the mouth of a lion.
Yeah, and so and the majority of it is caught still in rebellion, exactly as it was in the days that those minor prophets prophesied.
Yeah, and Amos 9 deals with that in a very horrific way. I mean, that's frightening what is said there about those who think that they are walking amongst the remnant.
And so when the people of Yahweh turn away from his ethics and his their heart becomes stony and not a circumcised soft heart to Yahweh, and they rebel, then the judgment of Yahweh comes upon them. But not only the judgment of Yahweh, but what we're saying is that it opens them up. They are defenseless because Yahweh has no is not a defender of them. And he opens them up. That's the whole issue of the exile. Being sent into the exile means that you've got no defenses, no national boundaries anymore. I mean, one of the things that's happening today is that the world order people want to destroy nation states.
Yeah.
All right? They want globalism. That's the war that's going on in the world today. The elites want globalism as opposed to people who want national boundaries to keep their traditions and so on. And you see this great war now happening between nationalism and between globalism happening in the world around us today, and how they're smashing it. They're smashing it economically, they're smashing it with all the migrants going all over Europe and wherever.
The Pope calls it the Arabian Spring.
Yeah. And he delights in it.
Oh, yes.
And so the issue is, why would he delight in it? Because, you see, that's one of the reasons, clearly, because they're saying, like, Sweden will not be Sweden, culturally Sweden, anymore in about 20 years. Denmark will be gone. You know, these places where the tribe of Dan was supposed, like France, where Reuben, where he was settled and so on. So they're smashing it that way. It's, again, coming against Jacob his seed.
Yeah.
And secondly, mixing it up so that Esau's seed will predominate everywhere. So not only are we dealing over the greater narrative with Satan trying to destroy Jacob, even the remnant in the last days, but Yahweh says he will protect his remnant in the last days. So just be encouraged. While we're talking about this, we know
there's a lot of encouragement
But on the other hand, we see that because there's no repentance and there's no, because I believe it's very strong in the last days to go into your house, close the door, and you put the commandments on your heart, on the lintel of your heart, on your borders of your house, etc., and you keep and you walk according to the ethics of Yeshua, taught us in keeping the law, then the hedge of protection can be there, just as Yahweh can stand in the door, just like the first Exodus, Passover, and the judge, the angel of darkness, whatever it was, passed over and didn't afflict the Israelites. But if you don't have that, then Satan's minions, which will be Esau, who's got a vengeance to simply destroy and slaughter Jacob, actually has a heyday.
Yep.
And he does this through various ways. He does this through infiltrating education, that is anti-Yahweh, through basically mixing the seed and pressing on with like this migration that's going on, through collapsing the economy and amassing all the wealth and bringing people into slavery, economic slavery. All the things we're starting to see in trends is the global orientation versus the people who want community, family. They're against all these different concepts, modern concepts, the defining of marriage and so on. Which stand against the word of Yahweh.
So. Yeah, I mean, if you want to identify Yahweh's people, you know, he gave Cain a mark. But the people of Yahweh, you know, like Jacob, they also have a mark. And that mark is the Sabbath of Yahweh,
right?
Of which Yeshua is the owner, if you like, right?
Yeah.
And the mark of Cain, for Cain, and Esau, if you look at Esau today, Esau also have a mark, but it's a totally different day, right?
Yeah.
Now, the question is, even if you keep the Sabbath, right, what is the most important thing in you keeping the Sabbath? If the Sabbath, in other words, is celebrated without Yeshua, right, it's no Sabbath at all.
because he is the master of the Sabbath.
He is the Lord of it, it says,
yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Yeah. So if he's outside of it, you can keep Sabbath as much as you like, but it's useless.
Mm.
You know? You might as well join Esau.
Yeah. Because you have an empty religion, basically.
Yeah. And you'll see with his judgments that Yahweh says to Judah, I'm going to judge you because you left my laws, precepts, and decrees.
Mm.
So then we say, well, that's not important anymore today. As long as we have Jesus, right, we're fine. Well, is that so? Is that what the minor prophets show us?
Mm. You must have the Sabbath and Yeshua.
I thought so.
Yeah. So if we look at, I just want to read here from Amos. It's just the beginning of my King James Bible here. And it says, the name of Amos means a burden, which is the key word of the book. And he was just a farmer, basically.
Yeah,
Amos,
he was a herdsman.
And he was pulled out, called out as Yahweh's prophet. And we find that most of his ministry was carried out in the northern kingdom. So he went specifically to the household of Israel during the time or the reign of Jeroboam II.
Yeah.
So, and this is when, remember, they've developed a whole lot of replacement theology. They've got their own temple, they've got their own priests, they've got their own calendar. They've set up all things to themselves, which is a replacement of what was originally set up, commanded by Yahweh. And so he gets a vision, which is quite strong, of impending judgment and scattering. Now, Amos was a contemporary. In other words, he was existing at the same time as Hosea, Micah, Isaiah, and Jonah. Now, that's interesting. He's existing at the same time as Jonah, who's commanded to take a word of repentance to Nineveh.
Which are basically the Gentiles, if you like.
Yeah, which is like things Nineveh today with ISIS has taken war against
Nineveh. Exactly the same place. Mosul is Nineveh.
Yeah. So so he comes up with no formal training, Amos. He's got a strong prophecy, and yet apparently he's able to write very well, because the book is written down. I mean, it's written with great structure, and he has great. He's a great orator, and his pleas are to the people to repent. And he predicts the destruction of Israel, and of course, his word then made him very unpopular.
Very.
Now, we see parallels today. Those people calling for repentance to anybody and saying that they don't want, don't go away. I'm not interested in that. The whole world now has heard the gospel. The Pope is not teaching the gospel. He's teaching world order ecumenicalism. He's teaching a completely different thing to what the scripture is calling for us. Mm-hmm. But Amos was very unpopular because he apparently ministered at the very peak of Israel's material and political success. So in other words, they had come to the pinnacle of their wealth and their political strength as a kingdom. Which again, you know, look at the West as it's risen up. It's at the pinnacle. Look at America. I watch the commentaries on America and its empire, and many people are saying now that it's actually, it can't sustain all these military camps that it puts all over the world and, you know, dominates the whole. It doesn't have the finances now because they've bankrupted themselves. You see, it's at the pinnacle. But yet you see people talking. I listen to some conservative radio stations in America, and some of the watchmen are calling for repentance as a nation, that they're going, saying that they're going to go into captivity and all this kind of thing. And what you find is that the people are still looking towards electing someone who will resurrect their country, like Donald Trump or somebody, you know, this thing. And they're not actually realizing that they're on the pinnacle of the collapse of the empire and the kind of situation that Hosea could be very much speaking into.
Exactly, because the American elite are as much as part of Babel.
Yeah.
And Babylon, that's going to fall, you know. And there's no two ways about it.
So they were enjoying a very prosperous reign under Jeroboam II, who had expanded Israel's territory and secured it from all external threats. And all of a sudden, along comes desolation, right? So Hosea observed what Moses predicted in Deuteronomy 6, 4-10, and Hosea 2, 5-13, that this prosperity caused the people to forget Yahweh.
Yeah, of which Moses warned them.
Yeah.
If you get there, you know, don't forget it.
So the hedge of protection is taken away. So now we've seen a president of America forcing, going around the whole world and forcing what Yahweh says is forbidden in terms of the definition of a holy set-apart marriage, and forcing it on the world. Right? For that alone, it seems to me that the issue of Sodom and Gomorrah becomes apparent. You mm-hmm. can't, unless there's great repentance, you can't but not expect that what has gone before will not be happening again.
Well, you see, and Yahweh gives Israel today big signs before this day turn, because you see, he's going to judge Damascus first.
Yes.
See? And if you go to Amos chapter 1.
Well, let me just finish this introduction, because that's where we need to go. That's what Amos is teaching us, a sequence of events, isn't
he? Yeah.
Okay, so let me just finish this introduction. So Amos strongly denounced the rich and privileged classes who were using their power to exploit the poor. Now, isn't that a summary statement of what's been happening? You know, for me, when we looked at us, I was talking with you earlier, how in 2008, 9, 10, is to me, because I, you know, looking at the parable of the great famine with Joseph in Genesis 45, you see how this famine comes and you see how this thing starts to collapse. And there's a very important statement made in about the third year of the timing of the seven-year famine. It says, and the money failed. And, you know, I was looking for this thing. Is it happening, or are we not in the time? But effectively, the economies and the money did fail. The economies failed in 2009, 2010 and around that area, because it was covered over by this quantitative easing, they call it, the printing of money, which has been a complete deception, because the economies have never recovered. They say, the media has said it's all recovered, the world has gone on, but it actually hasn't.
No, because it can't recover, because the people are enslaved in Egypt.
Yeah.
Let me give you an example.
And they're going into greater slavery, which is exactly the same as the Genesis narrative.
Today, the people that I work with, and I only work with them because I'm retired and I have something to do, but they work there. They have to take care of their families, you know? And the men do not earn enough money by working 60 hours a week to sustain their families.
Yeah.
Their wives and others within the family also have to work, otherwise they cannot make it. And even then it's touch and go, you know?
Yeah.
Totally enslaved. And you hear the politicians saying, I just heard it today in Holland, the economy is picking up and the economy is picking up, right? But on the other hand, they say consumption is really down, you know, because China is not producing anything and American consumption is really down. And then I heard one guy say, yes, you know why that is? Because the people don't have any money.
I can't buy anything.
Can't buy anything. It's as simple as that.
But when they say the economy is getting greater, it's because it's all smoke and mirrors of what's happening on the stock exchange and shares and people who buy and sell shares and stuff. So, you know, there's just so much to this. So what happens is Amos is actually speaking and denouncing the rich and the privileged. And I mean, if there's a word that I've often been praying about now, how long can Yahweh allow these people to get so rich when there's so much poverty and suffering in their nations, that, you know, these peoples have got so much wealth up, you can't even imagine it, and yet they still want to control more, you know. They don't even have a heart for any human being.
No, they don't.
For anybody. It's just amazing.
So
the rich and privileged classes were strongly denounced by Amos. And, you know, in the same case today, I think the rich and the privileged classes are going to be judged severely in the last days, who were using their power to exploit the poor. Amos cited several flagrant violations of specific social and legal stipulations in the law of Moses. I find that very interesting, because what was he saying that they had done against the law of Moses, right? Amos 2:6-8, 4:1, 5:7, 10-12, and chapter 8, verse 5-7. And he also condemned the false religion practiced at the altar of Bethel. So all this false religion, which is what, you know, we talked about the polemic. And it doesn't matter whether you go on Judah's side or on Israel's side, it's this polemic, which is a false religion, and is not related to what is actually written. It's what they say it is. And as a result, Amaziah, the false high priest of Bethel, rigorously opposed him.
Oh,
so,
yes.
So there's an interesting thing, because Amaziah is the false high priest.
Yep.
He is a picture of the anti-Messiah.
That's right.
Right?
Yep.
And so he rigorously opposed. One wonders whether Amos is not going to be paralleled by witnesses that are, you know, like the Revelation talks about two witnesses, whether one of them is. It's the same message that Amos brings. Just a thought.
Well,
you know,
I know one big false priest sits in Rome. He's as false as false can be, right?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. And he just wants to bring poverty to everybody.
Yeah.
As long, but they've got plenty of money themselves.
Oh, yes.
You know, they are wealthy heirs, you know.
Yes.
Anyway, so let's now look at Amos. What are we going to discuss?
Well, you see, the thing is, what's interesting is that when you read Amos chapter 1, you see that it is a judgment on Israel and its neighbors. And the first judgment comes to Israel's neighbor, which is Syria and Damascus. You know? And the interesting thing is that if you go to verse 5 of chapter 1, it says, I will break down the gate of Damascus. I will destroy the king who is in the valley of Ivan, and the one who holds the scepter in Beth Eden, the people of Aram. In other words, the people of Syria.
Of Syria, yes.
Yeah? Because how do we know this is Syria? Because if we go to Abraham, Isaac, and his wife, they went to Padan Aram. And there was Rivka's brother, Laman the Syrian, of Padan Aram. Yeah? So Aram is Syria, right? And it says, they will be exiled to Kir, K-I-R. And if you look that up, then you'll find out that Kir is Jordan, right? And today we have at least 1.7 million Syrians sitting in Jordan. Now, is that coincidental, or what is, was, and it will happen again, you know? So it's not a new situation. This may have happened in the past, but it's going to happen again. So before Israel, which we see, for example, in Amos 8 and 9, is going to be judged, we must see
the judgment of Syria.
The judgment of Syria, where they're being exiled from their land. Well, there is hardly anybody left because the place is rubble.
You see the photo. And that shows us, because Isaiah 17:1, right? Damascus shall become a ruinous heap, is such a significant, obviously, in terms of what shall happen again. That is set in Isaiah as a significant prophetic signpost. And here it's in the context of the whole book of Amos, and he's laying out first of all that what happens is the judgment of Syria, then comes later on the judgment of Israel, right?
Yeah, but before that comes, you have the destruction of Gaza.
Yes.
You know? Well, Gaza is being bombed and bombed all over the place, you know? It's also a heap of rubble, and you know, when this whole thing culminates, you know, and you can see this whole force coming through the Middle East, you know, the whole thing will be a mess.
With the Assyrian.
Yeah.
That's what we dealt with. For those who may be listening first time, we did a little audio on the Assyrian, Isaiah chapter 10, as a sign in the last days of the judgment of Yahweh and how he gets judged by Yeshua himself. So that's interesting.
So there is a number of judgments: Assyria, the Syrians, the Gazians, Lebanon. Going before, it's Israel's turn. And then you come to chapter 3, verse 1. I mean, you'd have to read all these things yourself. We can't go through this verse by verse, because we've got about 9 books to do, you know what I mean? But in verse 3, verse 1, it says, hear the word of Yahweh that he has spoken against you, O people of Israel, and to be specific, against the whole family that I brought out of Egypt. So this is the whole house.
Yeah, all 12 tribes.
All 12 tribes, right? Yes. You only have I chosen of all the families of the earth, and therefore I will punish you for your sins. So, it's all good and well saying we are Jews and we have an automatic right to the age to come. That might be Jewish theology.
Rabbinical theory.
Rabbinical theology, yeah. But Yahweh says to the whole house of Israel that it will be punished for its sins. Yeah, as Damascus was punished, and as Gaza will be punished, so also will Israel be punished.
You see, the rabbinics by that statement turn away the authority of Yeshua as the only way that one can be redeemed and forgiven from your sins, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so when they say, you know, if you convert to rabbinicalism, because only rabbinical Judaism, that automatically, by their keeping of their religious law, the rabbinical law, they have an automatic right to the coming millennial reign.
That's right.
Well, this is going to be severely judged. That's what you're telling me here.
Yeah, yeah.
And the issue is, I just want to come back to Amos 3, 1 and 2, because the next verse 3 says, the question Yahweh says, can two walk together except they be agreed? So, you know, we've got to agree with Yahweh. We can't agree with religion.
Exactly.
And if you're with religion and it doesn't agree with Yahweh, you're out of the covenant.
Yeah.
You're banging your head against the wall.
Yeah. So you have to really now make up your mind, you know, what is biblical Israel? Yeah. You know? Don't worry about rabbinical Israel, because as you can see, they are sitting, you know, in the front row with the Pope as well. You know? In prayer shawls and capels,
you know,
and the
busy. Everybody's busy working on an ecumenical religion.
Exactly. That's why the Pope says, you know, this Arabian Spring is wonderful, because the Dutch Reformed now also take off their shoes when they enter the mosques. Yeah, because they're nice people, and we go and visit them, and you know. And the more Muslims we have, the more our world religion,
will all be
mixed and accepted, and you know, it's not a problem. And we're going to have the big jubilee in October 2017.
Big Roman jubilee.
The big Roman jubilee of the Pope, October 2017.
When all the Protestants will be all in unity too.
All the prominent Protestants, including the Lutherans, have already signed the unification agreement, right? This is the jubilee that's going to be celebrated exactly on the 500th birthday of Martin Luther putting his thesis against the door.
Yeah.
Exactly on that date. And those leaders of those Christian denominations have sold their hearts and souls to the devil by signing this unification agreement, which is going to be celebrated in 2007.
And so when he says, can two walk together except they be agreed? Yahweh is saying, you can't, really.
Can't.
You can't unless you agree. But when the Protestants and the Romans and the Rabbinics and the Islamics all walk together, it says they're agreed.
They're agreed.
That's it.
Yeah.
So therefore, you've got Yahweh on this side.
Right.
And that's why he says, come out of Babylon, my people. Come out of her, my people, lest you participate in the plagues that are going to come upon her. This is this mystery, Babylon, which is all agreed in their ecumenicalism. And they change what's written in the Bible. I wouldn't be surprised if, this is just me, that when they come out with this jubilee, they'll produce a new Bible.
Probably.
And they'll take away all the minor major prophets and the book of the law. And they'll just put in, because once you we've seen that in Christendom, once you take away the Old Testament and you've just got the new, you can make him make Yeshua like Gandhi. You know what I'm saying? You can make him just, because you don't have the basis of the law.
Yeah.
Yeshua is a representative of the law and the prophets, you see.
And don't forget, you know, that in the United States, the Roman Catholic leadership, you know, is very influential over the power base of America.
Yeah, in both parties.
They are Babylon, you know. And this is what the people there have to realize, you know. It's not some sort of nice religious order.
No, well, they don't see that.
Whereas they're interested.
Very few see that, evangelicals today. They just sort of, what's more important to Americans, I've come to learn in watching this latest election, I never understood this. What's important to Americans is that you're a conservative more than you are a believer. So they can't sort out, so they can have their conservative activism happening, but they mix up the Catholics, the Mormons, everything together, as long as we're conservative, but, you know, that's all together. So they're all going that vote for empirism, for the vote, it doesn't matter whether it's a Democrat or Republican. It's just that the Democrats and Republicans, they all call themselves conservatives, but they're not really. I
mean, okay, so then, you know, two must be agreed, right?
Yeah.
So if we are evangelicals, right, and we support the rebuilding of a temple in Jerusalem by the Temple Mount faithful, who reject Yeshua as Messiah, right? But still you support it.
Because your theology says it must be, this is Yahweh's temple.
You are not walking with the same sort of people, are you, that you should be walking with?
Yeah. Now the thing is, it's because the people are ignorant, they haven't read the scriptures, but the thing is that the leaders have deliberately done this because they haven't taught these scriptures, because of their theology, you see?
So therefore they must listen to Amos chapter 3 verse 7, which says, surely the sovereign Yahweh does nothing, right? He does nothing without revealing his plan to his servants, the prophets.
In my version it says, surely Yahweh Elohim will do nothing, but he reveals his secret, which is his plan, is kept hidden, actually. It's got a stronger meaning there, unto his servants, the prophets, because it's not being revealed, the judgment of what Yahweh is going to do, because he says, in another scripture, I'm going to do things that nobody's even seen.
Yeah, you know why this is? Because Satan wants to know Yahweh's plan.
Yeah.
But therefore, we also don't have all the answers.
No,
because some of the answers are concealed, not as much maybe for ours, but certainly for the devil's situation.
The way the judgment is going to happen.
That he doesn't know Yahweh's full plan.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you could preempt him. Yeah. You know?
The lion has roared, who will not fear? Yahweh Elohim has spoken, and who can but prophesy? Yeah, so it's interesting. You see, when one is prophesying about the gospel of the kingdom, and one takes this in the last days, as Yeshua is preaching, repent for the kingdom of Yahweh is at hand. When we say today, repent for the kingdom of Yahweh is at hand, we've got the wisdom of the minor prophets as a template for how we can testify in the last day.
Exactly. So then he says in Amos 3, verse 11, and remember that he's talking about the whole house of Israel, right? He says in verse 11, therefore this is what the sovereign Yahweh says. An enemy will overrun the land. He will pull down your strongholds and plunder your fortresses. This is what the sovereign Yahweh says. As a shepherd saves from the lion's mouth only two leg bones or a piece of an ear, so will the Israelites be saved.
Yeah.
In other words, there is an enemy going to come and overrun the land, and later on we will see who that enemy is, which we already know is the Assyrian, because there is a specific...
Isaiah chapter 10.
Yeah, but in these minor prophets is a specific judgment for this Assyrian of what he has done to Israel, right?
Through this invasion.
Yeah.
So, but the Assyrian is the, according to Isaiah 10, is the rod of Yahweh's anger for the judgment of Israel.
Israel, yeah. Absolutely.
And so, I mean, I find it very interesting at the moment how Turkey, what they've been doing in relation to ISIS, it's all being revealed, right? And how they're working together with the Arabs, for example, against Syria right at the moment. Russia's involved there too. But the scriptures are telling us it's not the Arabs who are going to actually invade Israel, ultimately take possession of... it's the judgment specifically of Jerusalem. It's not the judgment of Israel per se, but it's Israel is in possession of it. But affects Israel worldwide, the scattered tribes, because look at what's happened from it when he's sending from... I mean, the EU is now trying to talk to Turkey to take these migrants back to Turkey and put these... You know, because that invasion, and the Pope has said it is an invasion of the Arabs coming over, but he tries to tell everybody this is a good thing. So the judgment of the Assyrian at this time is a bit different, because the judgment is happening to the West as these migrants are coming in and carrying the same religious doctrines, and then you've got Babylon mixing it up and making it so that people are... Nationalism is being broken down, the religious persuasions are being broken down, as we know, the Abrahamic faith. And we know from the occultic writings that they have deliberately planned this because they want to destroy Jacob. And the way they're going to do it is pit the Abrahamic faiths against each other. So that people are so angry that they end up in these mixed nations now. And you can see it already. You can see, like I saw an article... in, was it Norway or Sweden or something? They had the thing there, the soldiers of Odin or something. And they walked, the guys walked in the streets to protect their families. Now, now you've got the Islamic rising up with their soldiers. Do you see what I'm saying? Right in the middle of Sweden. And so this is a taste of what's coming. And the adversary judges Jerusalem, which is the real picture, but it's actually affecting all the nations at the same time. That's all I'm trying to get to.
Mm-hmm.
It's not simply, although the sign is he invades Jerusalem and is judged, the damage of what he's doing affects the whole world.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah?
Yeah. Yeah, you'll see later on, you know, in the judgment of the nations, you know. Yeah. I mean, if you look at the nations, and if you look at Protestantism, you know, in Central Europe, right, and how they now have sold out and signed this
unification
agreement with Rome, right?
Yeah.
And how they have allowed, you know, Allah, yeah, to become the most prominent, yeah, in Holland, in Belgium, in Germany, Scandinavia, you name it.
That's Moscow. Because they turned away from Yahweh and
exactly.
They pursued riches, wealth, and prosperity.
Exactly.
And
Yahweh is going to judge them because he is righteous, you know. Their sin has to be full. And then the sin of the Amalekites, right, who has always tried to wipe out Jacob, right, will be full. And then he will judge the nations. And his judgment will be righteous and just.
So I just want to say at the time, remember that Joseph said in this whole situation, because everybody's going into the slavery of Pharaoh, that's the ultimate goal, and Pharaoh being Satan, is that Joseph said to his people, he said, don't be afraid, when he revealed himself to them, he said, don't be afraid, that Yahweh has sent him ahead, everything to prepare our redemption and deliverance. Through this whole process, there will be a redemption of the remnant and a safekeeping. So I just want to be encouraged with those words at the same time while we're talking about this. But what we've speaking about so far, I think you can see this unfolding right now on the headlines of the informal news. You don't see anything much of it in the mainstream media. But if you join all the dots as to what's actually happening, I think very clearly I'm seeing what Amos was talking about way back then.
Yep. And you know, if you go to chapter 4, verse 11, it says, I overthrew some of you as I overthrew Sodom and Gomorrah. You, and he's talking to Israel, you were like a burning stick snatched from a fire, which is exactly what they are. 1940, 1945. Israel was snatched from a fire. A remnant, you know, which was, you know.
Are you speaking about Judah?
Yeah.
Do you know?
He was Satan, right? Destroying, yeah, on the one hand, the house of Judah. He knows where Messiah has to come from, you know? And Yahweh snatched him like he snatched him from a fire.
Well, I heard, as you talk about that, I was listening to Rick Wiles on True News Radio this last week, and he gave an interesting statistic. So where he got it from, I don't know. But he said it, and he reinforced it about three times. He said, do you know that about 60% of the people who died in the concentration camps of Germany, or wherever they were, under Hitler, 60% of them were evangelical believers. 60%, that's what he's saying. So, you know, I mean, I don't know. But I think there's a message in it that it wasn't just Judah that was persecuted in those concentration camps. Because I know there were a lot of German evangelicals that went to the concentration camps and died as well. You know, the Lutherans that stood up against
No,
the same with the Dutch people.
Yeah, absolutely.
And there would have been the same elsewhere with other nations.
So Yahweh, you know, gives Israel a warning in chapter 5, verse 4, where he says,
Before you go there, so let's just read verse 12. Therefore, of chapter 4, therefore thus will I do unto thee, O Israel, and because I will do this unto thee, prepare to meet your Elohim,
absolutely,
O Israel. So, you know, we know now, with understanding the two houses of Israel, we know this historical migrations of the tribes of Israel. We know from that. And I'm not talking British Israelism or anything like that. We know that the Western, mainly the Western, Ephraim and Reuben and Dan and where they went and settled. So this is talking about a judgment, I believe, to a large degree, on the whole of the Western empires or the Western nations, the ones that actually experienced the Protestant Reformation. That's being snatched like a brand from a fire tooth, was the Protestant Reformation. And he pulled them out, and you saw this wonderful blessing as a consequence of them turning to Yahweh and Yeshua and rediscovering the gospel of salvation by faith and the gospel. You saw this incredible enlightenment come, going back and the going back to the ethics of Yahweh and living in faith of Yahweh, you see?
Yeah.
And so this kind of thing is going to happen there. He says, I've overthrown some of you as Elohim overthrew Sodom and Gomorrah. I'm not going to be surprised to see a few incinerated cities in the West coming up, according to this, because that's the way Sodom and Gomorrah was judged.
Well, if you look at the world where it is today, and I read the other day in one of the Scandinavian countries, they now want to legalize pedophilia and having sex with the dead.
Yeah.
You have to say, yeah, well, you've got to do something, otherwise you have to apologize to Sodom and Gomorrah, you know.
And you were as a firebrand, so the people you were as a firebrand plucked out of the burning. So there was this Protestant Reformation out of great struggle, and they overcame, they succeeded. And there was this consequent enlightenment and also this flight to the new worlds because of the oppression of Esau, who wanted to force them back, you see, this whole war against Esau, against Protestantism, but they fled for... because of religious freedom, seeking religious freedom. And they prospered in that religion. But they turned away, and they've all gone, because now they said New Zealand is no longer a Christian country, Australia is no longer, you see, and they're all into cultural Marxism and atheism and these kind of things, breaking down everything against
Look at America, where they all went,
yeah,
because they were promised freedom.
And it says, and you have not returned, because he said, you have not returned unto me, therefore I will do unto you, O Israel, because I will do this, and because I do this unto you, prepare to meet your Elohim. So that says to me that's the sign. All right, the judgment of Israel with the Assyrian coming in and Damascus, these events rejoining together, is again a sign for the imminent judgment by Yahweh of the nations in the last days, particularly Israel.
Yeah.
I'm talking about the nations of Israel, but a redeemed Israel will be brought out through it.
Yeah, we will see that. And
so you went to chapter 5.
Yeah. Chapter 5, verse 14, you know?
Verse 14.
Seek good, not evil.
Seek good and not evil.
That you may live.
Yes.
Then Yahweh your Elohim will be with you, just as you say he is.
Okay, so now let me just stop here, because for 20 odd years or so, we got awakened to this whole thing, this calling about returning to ancient paths. We became delusioned with what we were hearing, because we heard in the denominations of Christendom it didn't match to this issue of the law has been done away with, that Yeshua has replaced the law. And so we started moving down that route. The issue is that the Hebraic Roots movement has devolved into, in my view, this is my assessment of it, it has devolved, because it's been infiltrated. It has devolved not into Hebraic heritage, which is a valuable thing to study, but the Jewish roots of the faith. You often hear this, the Jewish, all going back to the rabbinic, in other words, I'll take the Jewish roots, the rabbinical roots of the faith, which we know is false, because the Dead Sea Scrolls tell us when this started to come up, and it only came up about 160 years before Yeshua came. And so, When you see a scripture like this, seek good and not evil, this is now where we get back to this issue of search your heart and make sure that your heart is circumcised with seeking the ethics of the scriptures, the ethics, not the religion of commandments, but the ethics on the heart of how Yeshua is teaching, how the law is actually an outward form, but what he's really looking for is the inward ethics. And he's saying, seek the good and not evil. At a time now, we've got to be very, because this says that, do this so that you will live.
Yeah.
So our redemption begins in the last days. We know, if I can just say it this way, we know that it is Yeshua alone who brings the redemption. You can't actually have forgiveness of sin without Yeshua. But in the last days, he's talking about this repentance that has to happen, where you seek good, and good is defined biblically, not humanistically, according to atheism and secular humanism. So, because to secular humanism, is what the Pope preaches. Marxism. Oh, everybody good together, intolerance, and doesn't matter, you know, and don't read the, if you have a, what he says, if you are a scripturalist, you've got a mental illness type thing, right? No. What we've got to do is see the issue of what Yahweh says, and it's the way of Yeshua, is how we are to seek good and not evil, that you may live. So somehow there's something incredible here that it's not simply a profession of Yeshua, but it's also an active thing where we will confront our own hearts, confront our own behavior, and make sure that we are, I suppose the picture is the bride cleansing her garment, you know, of every strain and blemish that we can possibly do. Now, I know that that's not possible. It's like, don't think that I'm saying that this replaces the work, the sanctified work of Yeshua. It doesn't. It's actually taking both. He's quite clear that it takes a repentant heart to seek good and to seek Yahweh's kingdom and to seek his ethical precepts, right? And to live in accord with them as best we can all the time, whilst the blood of Yeshua is covering us and cleansing us, that where we do fail, we can confess it, repent from it, confess the sin and change and move on. Mm-hmm. In other words, having a soft heart before Yahweh.
Yeah,
and so Yahweh, Elohim of hosts, shall be with you as you have spoken.
Yeah.
I find that's very encouraging.
Hate evil, love good,
yeah.
Maintain justice in the courts, and then perhaps Yahweh your Elohim will have mercy on the remnant of Joseph.
When it says establish judgment in the gate, it's saying that don't take on all these humanistic Marxist ethical principles in your house. And
yeah.
in the community that you're going to walk. Rather set, you must, it's the same scripture that's got, be separate as I am separate. Come out of her, my people, right? So again, this comes up as the end time judgment of Babylon.
Therefore, this is what the sovereign Yahweh says. There will be wailing in all your streets and cries of anguish in every public square. The farmers will be summoned to weep and the mourners to wail. There will be wailing in all your vineyards, for I, that is Yahweh, will pass through your midst.
Yeah, so essentially what we're seeing with the mass migration of the EU at the moment, this is actually, Joseph is in control of all this. Huh?
Yeah.
Because we're talking about, let's put it another way. It's like, which we were discussing the other day, like the sons of the Spirit is redeemed Israel. And there was this great Protestant Reformation and there was great outpouring of Yahweh's, you know, because you can see our civilization was, Western civilization was blessed by it,
mm-hmm.
and became prosperous. But they turned away and they went in, on the other hand, when there was this great enlightenment from the enlightenment from the Roman bondage, there was also an enlightenment amongst those who totally rejected Yahweh. And they made academic secular enlightenment. So the sciences grew and all this because it got free from Rome, which kept the bondage, because it stopped the people from thinking that the earth was flat. You know? which is back again.
Yeah.
Which is really bananas, really. I mean, the very fact that how the calendar works shows you clearly that you can't have a flat earth. And the fact that we've got seasons and they're different in the northern hemisphere to the southern hemisphere on the very same day shows you that it's impossible for the earth to be flat. I mean, what madness. That's another thing. An affliction that is coming is that the people go mad, insane. So what happened is that those against Yahweh in the Enlightenment prospered. And they come to an end, which they are mad in their own prosperity. They look at contemporary modern art, where you just see all this, it's so beautiful, and it's so abstract, and it's, what is it? Well, it's how you interpret it to be, you see. Of course, this is it's actually, on the other side, it's like the king's got no clothes. There's no art there, really. It's just, you know, the more turmoil, I've heard it described very well, that modern art is where you put the mess of the madness of the painter. He makes it in a way that the person comes along and takes the madness of the painter into himself. Do you see what I'm saying? He says,
yeah.
Oh, it's beautiful.
Yeah.
You see?
Yeah.
So, and so this kind of thing happens. This enlightenment has happened that is against Yahweh. So you've got these two forces, right?
Yeah.
And And so we have a situation where the West is in my view, today, in a state of existential despair, because they look at it this way: you can't preach the gospel of the kingdom anymore. They will have none of it. They know it. They will have none of it. What Rome is now doing is not preaching the gospel of the kingdom, but talking ecumenicalism, where they will rule. So another way of commandments and a way of religion, so you can have religion. There are no answers. The people, when I listen to the conservative Christian radio and things like that that's happening around the world, the people are crying out for leaders. That's what they're doing. That's what they're saying now. Evangelicals in America will vote for Donald Trump. They want a strong man. Even though they can't agree with much of the way he behaves and what he says, they still want a strong man. And so you can see that compromise. And you hear this: wailing shall be in all the streets, and they shall say in all the highways, alas, alas, and they shall call the husbandman to the mourning. They're calling for strong men. Help us in our predicament. Help us. Now, isn't that happened in Holland? What Absolutely. About Wilders? What about that guy Wilders? They want a strong man. Yeah. Right? The people will all vote
people
for him,
want, yeah.
But the globalists and the parliamentarians are making sure that he can never get power as far as they're concerned.
Exactly.
America's happening exactly the same. It's happening the same in England with United UKIP
it's
Party.
It's happening in England. It's happening in Germany. It's happening in France. It's happening in Belgium.
It's happening in America. So the people are craving for... They're suffering and they're craving for nationalism and security, and they've got these other people because the masses aren't, it's actually thwarting them all the time. And so you have this wailing that's going on. And they're waking up to the fact that their civilization is crumbling very fast.
Yeah. And then we come to verse 16, which we have to read. We have to read this whole bit because it's very, very pertinent. So we're in chapter 5 from verse 18. Woe to you who long for the day of Yahweh. Why do you long for the day of Yahweh? That day will be darkness and not light. It will be as though a man fled from a lion only to meet a bear. As though he entered his house and rested his hand on the wall only to have a snake bite him. Will not the day of Yahweh be darkness, not light, pitch dark, without the ray of brightness? I, that is Yahweh, hate. I despise your religious feasts. I cannot stand your assemblies. Even though you bring me burnt offerings and grain offerings, I will not accept them. Though you bring choice fellowship offerings, I will not regard them. I will have no regard for them. Away with the noise of your song, I will not listen to the music of your harps. Now this is identical, like we started off, what was, is, and will be again. It was exactly like that in the period of 2 Kings 17. They say, we are serving Yahweh. No, they were running after Baal.
Yep.
You know? There is nothing new
under the sun.
Yeah. Here it is again.
Exactly. You see, this is, you know, it's a... It tells us something. Woe to you that desire the day of Yahweh. I mean, we don't look to the day of Yahweh. We really don't want to see the day of Yahweh, because we are all needing to still be changing our own hearts, you know what I'm saying? Continuing to grow and continuing to stand in Yeshua and learning the way to walk. And when it comes to the end, there's no... When the tragedy of the day of Yahweh coming is that it's the end. There's no time for repentance now. You see, the mercy of Yahweh is that this hasn't happened yet. So don't desire it to come, because there's still time for repentance. There's still time for repentance, which is a good day. But when you can't repent anymore, that's when the righteous go into their homes and close the doors. It's not that we are to desire. It's a very difficult thing to understand this, I find. We are not to desire, and yet we are to hasten the coming of the day. That seems to be a contradiction. Well, the only way we can hasten the day is to be earnest about the callings that Yahweh has given us as servants to be about doing what we can, right? But we don't want to see that day coming, because it's going to be a bad day.
Yeah.
So rather we don't yearn for the day of Yahweh. What the day of Yahweh we yearn for is in that day, is the day of yearning, when Yeshua comes to redeem his people. That's the day we yearn for, right? So when it says in verse 20, shall not the day of Yahweh be darkness and not light, even very dark and no brightness in it? There is a scripture that says when the great darkness descended on the Egyptians, on the Israelites and the Egyptians in the time of the Great Exodus. It says there was light in the houses of the Israelites. So, when there's another meaning to me on this verse 18, woe unto you that desire the day of Yahweh. It's like, come on, bring it on. That's the attitude. It's not the, I mean, we've got to tread carefully about the day of Yahweh. But the arrogant or the people who are the globalist or the Satanist or whoever says, come on, we're going to have this duel because this is what it's about. But the war is Satan's going to fight against Yeshua. Bring it on. Yeah, because I read the occult, Boaz, and what I know from the white occultism, and you read it in the Alice Bailey and all these occultists, is that they planned these last 300 years. These ones, when the Enlightenment came, it was so infiltrated to overthrow Protestantism that they planned the Luciferic eschatological, using the scriptures. They plan it, and they plan these world wars and so on, such to the point where we get now where all the Abrahamic faiths will, supposed Abrahamic faith, but not necessarily the true faith, as you and I understand the biblical faith, will end up destroying each other. So that, which is what they'll do, they'll bring the true Luciferic religion, that everybody will run for it because they're looking for this redemption. Where's the husbandman? In other words, we want everybody, this what we call the anti-Messiah. You know, we will take him, let him bring peace to the earth. That's why I say they are the engineers of this, which I believe is Esau.
Yeah, absolutely. That's
we are planning this because I've heard from their very mouths when I spoke with a guy, because I was talking to him and we were talking about the gospel and so on and everything like this, and he was saying that basically what I couldn't resolve with him, that he was against Yeshua. He acknowledged that Yeshua was the son of Yahweh. He acknowledged that he was raised from the dead. He acknowledged that Yeshua would be coming again, and yet he was in a white witch type, occultic type environment, and I couldn't understand this. I said, well, how can you say all these things and then you actually don't submit to him and follow him? And he said, no, you do not understand. He said, he got away from us the first time. This time we are going to make all the plans and we will destroy him. That's the issue. Then the Pope comes along just a few months ago saying that Yahweh made a failure on the cross.
Yeah.
Right? Exactly. It's the same speak.
Same speak, yeah.
Right? So the issue is, woe to you that desire the day of Yahweh, are those saying, bring it on, because we're going to take control of this earth.
Yeah. Or those who are ignorant of the facts, right, who say, well, let the day of Yahweh come because then we're going to rapture up to heaven. You know?
Yeah, well, as I said to you earlier, there's the naivety on the believer's side. We don't desire it because we desire Yahweh's mercy, because it is going to the day hasn't arrived yet. Let's wait. It's going to come. We know it's going to come. So we don't, we rather focus on the time while there is light and there is mercy. That's how we should be. So that's one way of looking at that scripture. But the other side of this, when you're looking at the enemy side of this, they are desiring to build all their plans together so that the day of Yahweh will be brought to them and they will overcome it. You see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And he's saying to them, you are going to come very, very short. You are going to be judged in this. And he says, what end is it for you to judge this day? Because you think you're going to get the victory ultimately, and you're not. It's actually your destruction is coming. So you can desire it and plan for it, and when you get it, you're going to be destroyed.
Yeah.
Right? Shall not the day of Yahweh be darkness and not light, even very dark and no brightness in it? So there's the Esau there, but there's also the issue of the, as you say, the believer don't desire for the day of Yahweh, because that's why I say, keep on, let's look for mercy, because show us, Father, where we're wrong. That's why he then says, because I hate and I despise your feasts. We got to learn, why did he hate and despise the feasts?
But note that he says your feast. Doesn't say my feasts, your feasts.
Your feasts.
So obviously your feasts are wrong.
Yeah, but it could also be the institution, the religious institutions of the world.
Exactly.
All their feasts, you see.
Yeah. I can't stand your assemblies. Why? Because they are not worshipping him at all. You know, I mean, I went to some church some time ago, and the one who was most central there was Satan. We've got to go and fight Satan, you know. Let's go and pray, and we go and pray against Satan, you know. Whilst the scripture says, those who are in Yeshua, Satan will have no hold over them. So what's the big deal, right? Forget about Satan.
It's because they're talking about dominionism. It's a dominionist theology. So the last days, exactly as you say in Kings, that there are those who say they follow Yahweh, yep, but they do not.
Right.
They say they're doing the things of Yahweh, but they are not doing it.
Right.
There's this great apostasy is actually happening. So in the book of Revelation, it says this time of a great falling away. There's not as though there's no religion. There's not as though there's no humanism or anything like this. It's just a different law, different ethics, different religion. And so they, some of these in the parties that on the Israel side, they say, well, the day of Yahweh can come because we will be delivered. And actually, Yeshua says, many shall come to me in that day and say, Master, Master, didn't we do this in your name? Didn't we? And he says, and woe for me, you who commit iniquity.
Exactly. So then he says, you know, then he says, so the message is to those who presume that they are keeping Yahweh's feasts. And who presume that they are in his assemblies, if they don't wake up and change and repent, they will be exiled from him. That's how the chapter
And as we said, if Yeshua is not in them, you haven't got them.
No, you haven't got them.
No.
You
because
will be exiled from him.
Because the key of it is the Sabbath festival, and he is the master of the Sabbath.
Absolutely.
So, you know, you can take as much Hebraic roots as you like. If Yeshua is not in it, you've got problems.
If on your Sabbath the candles are prominent, and you leave Yeshua out, that's not gonna work.
And the candles shouldn't be there because they're not part of the law anyway.
Exactly. But you know, that's just to make the point. You know,
that's right.
You see, and then you come to chapter 6, verse 1. Woe to you who are complacent in Zion. So we're not talking about Gentiles here. We're not talking about, if you feel that you are part and parcel of the Zion of Yahweh, then you cannot be complacent.
Yeah.
But and you will feel secure among Samaria. You notable men of the foremost nation to whom the people of Israel came.
Now, just if you back up to chapter 5, verse 26, it says, but you have borne the tabernacle of your Moloch and Chion your images, the star of your God, which you made to yourself.
Yeah. The star, if you don't go away from that, you're out.
Yeah, but the star of their God, you know, I've done this research before. It's all on the website, tracing where the origin of the moon calendar, the lunar calendar, because the star of their God is the lunar calendar. It doesn't matter which religion you go to.
Nimrod.
You go all the way back, but it goes right back to Nimrod, but it goes before that because the watchers, we're told in the book of Enoch, introduced that. So it goes right the way through. If you go to Egypt, they kept two calendars, ancient Egypt. They kept an equinox calendar that was purely for agriculture, for their seasons. And all their religious, and they had many deities, all the religious festivals were held on a lunar-based calendar. So if you go all the way through, if you look at Rome and Protestantism, it's lunar calendar.
Yeah.
If you look at Rabbinicalism, it's lunar calendar. If you look at Islam, it's lunar calendar. If you look at all the Eastern faiths, it's lunar calendar. So when we're talking about the star of your God, there's only one star that's treated, one of the stars, and that is the moon. Because in as I've researched back, in ancient Babylon, the moon is the eye of Osiris.
Yeah.
That's where it all comes, which is Nimrod.
Yeah.
Right? So that's where it all comes. It's all collectively there.
Exactly.
And, it's one
and Nimrod, of course, it starts with Cain. Cain is the ruler of evil.
Yeah.
He is, absolutely.
So woe to them, chapter 6, verse 1, that are at ease in Zion and trust in the mountain of Samaria. Now that was the mountain, at the mountain of Samaria was the replacement temples.
Yeah. Yeah.
And the king of Samaria, the mountain of Samaria, which is Jeroboam, which are named chief of the nations to whom the house of Israel came. Yeah. So, you know, this apostate religion, people are going to trust in it. So, to be a scripturalist today is to be, if you are a scripturalist, you will not find a happy place in any kind of institutional religion today.
No.
Denominational wise, I don't believe you will do. It's just because Yahweh's calling his people out. Come out, come out, come out.
Yeah. Come out of Babylon. Because in 6:14 he says that he will stir up the nations against Israel if they do not repent.
So the Israel, yeah, as Israel will be destroyed. In the time of Amos, it was the northern kingdom.
Yeah.
But in our day, I believe this Israel to be destroyed is the Western nations. The Western nations now. Now, there's many ways of looking at this because, there's, you know, let a thing be more than two witnesses, right? I've looked at the rise and fall just generally of empires, going back the Roman Empire, the Greek Empire, and so on. And it seems to be quite curious that even the Roman Empire, which was revived again with Christendom, okay, what they call Roman Christianity, and then ended up in a dark age. If you take the ancient Roman pagan empire, the ancient empires as they came, Greece, and then the Roman church empire, they start with Constantine, they had a lifespan, uncannily, of approximately 600 years. They go through a cycle where they come up, and you can see how their philosophy, their ethics change as they get more prosperous, and then how they get into fighting, like you see even in America, everybody fights against each other, they can't agree on anything, and then they fall into existentialist-like view. Nobody can agree on an absolute truth anymore. And then they begin to collapse, and they collapse really fast. And it's been 600 years, 600 years, 600 years. If you take from Rome, Constantine, to the Dark Ages and the collapse, 600 years when they collapsed. Then you take Protestantism. It's now 600 years, coming into 600 years. You see, the whole thing has come up, and it's formed its own kingdoms, and now it's collapsing. And it is. Yep. Protestantism is collapsing.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So all these empires are collapsing. And in the West, there's a greater narrative of the Western democracy. Now, I've always had this conviction that this dark day of darkness that Yahweh is talking is going to be where, if the narrative of Genesis 45 tells us that everyone who was not part of in Goshen of the house of Joseph, if they were not there, they went into voluntary slavery, and then this Pharaoh comes with a different economic system. He crashes the money system. He brings them all into slavery without private property. You're talking about all the nations being brought into a new global order, but not Joseph, not the house of Jacob. See? And so at the beginning of the millennium, it seems to me, and it's just thinking through this thing, because I believe that the millennial reign is an outpouring to the nations again. The law of Yahweh will go forth to the nations, but
absolutely,
the nations have to come up in submission. But in the period of transition, all the nations will be in darkness, and the people of Yahweh will be brought out so that they are the light of the world, and they will be the example with Yeshua in their midst, and then the nations will truly learn of them, and the law will go forth from Zion. So that means you can't have this current world order that we see, or the future world order that they intend. What you will have, they might think it's enlightened, but it's not. You will have a world of darkness. The nations will go into darkness, like a new dark age. And yet Joseph will be with his people. It's like Goshen, but in the midst of all this. And then it'll grow, and it'll grow. As I understand the millennial reign, as the nations repent, and more of Israel repents, it'll grow and it'll grow and it'll grow.
Yep.
So that's what I believe is a picture. Oh, okay.
So if we then go, you know, we can't go through every verse here. I mean, it'd be too long. But if we go to chapter 7, verse 1, this is what the sovereign Yahweh showed me. He was preparing swarms of locusts after the king's share had been harvested, and just as the second crop was coming up, when they had stripped the land clean, I cried out, "Sovereign Yahweh, forgive. How can Jacob survive? He is so small." So Yahweh relented.
For this
will not happen.
It shall not be, says Yahweh. He repented. That's verse 3 of chapter 7.
Yep.
Yahweh repented for this. It shall not be. So this is Amos said, and I said, O Yahweh Elohim, forgive, I beseech thee. By whom shall Jacob arise? For he is but small.
Yep.
See, what are you going to? What is your comment there?
So, for me, it looks as though there is no hope for Jacob, right?
Yes.
As in Daniel's time, you know, there was no hope for Israel, right? And we see the great Daniels and Nehemiahs and Amoses,
making
right?
that repentant
making
prayer.
That repentant prayer, interceding for the nation so that Yahweh relents, you know what I mean? Because so that's what we ought to be doing. That's what we ought to be doing.
Well, let me
interceding.
Just this is very important.
Yeah.
So Daniel 9, he comes up, if you want to read this, and I've commented on this prayer of Daniel's, because Solomon actually made this prayer too when he reinstated the temple.
Yeah.
Nehemiah definitely made it.
Yeah.
We see it in Nehemiah. Moses is calling about it, calls for it, the last generation, to make this prayer.
Yeah.
So if you haven't heard this before, you go to Daniel 9, and you read Daniel 9, and he says from verse 3, and I set my face unto Yahweh Elohim, because remember, Daniel is in exile. And he's wondering about all these promises, and they haven't come about. And he begins to make this incredible prayer of intercession.
Yeah.
And if you read it, remember, Daniel was of the house of Judah. And he prays not just for the house of Judah, but he prays for the whole house of Jacob, all of Israel, and their repentance who are gathered, who are far away to make this. What you're saying is exactly what we have been convicted to do at Shavuot. Have been convicted at our Feast of Pentecost every year, is to make this confession of the same thing, that Yahweh will remember his people and acknowledge our iniquity and how he has punished Israel, ancient Israel, our forefathers and ancient. And this is the intercession, what you're pointing about, that is necessary for us in the last days who have understood this. Because who else will make this intercession except those who've actually come to the understanding, has been revealed to them? This is what I require.
So we don't argue about the length of our tzitzit. We don't argue about how many candles we burn.
That's all irrelevant. Religion is irrelevant.
We don't argue, now we're taking the Enoch calendar and tomorrow, no, he's got to be by the moon and the day. No.
Oh, but you better worry, the world is flat now and it's not round and we've got to make a religion of this and congregations who keep the flat earth, you know. Oh, how ridiculous can it be?
So this is the message.
The message is Daniel 9 prayer, the prayer of intercession.
And Yahweh asked me, what do you see, Amos? He says, a plumb line, I replied. Then Yahweh said, look, I'm setting a plumb line among my people Israel. I will spare them no longer. The high places of Isaac will be destroyed, and the sanctuaries of Israel will be ruined. With my sword, I will rise against the house of Jeroboam.
With the sword.
With the sword.
That's what mine says, with the sword.
Yeah.
And that's interesting, because what is the sword that we're seeing right now?
Yes, I mean, there is another one of the minor prophets, where Yahweh says, I'm going to do something that if I told you, you wouldn't believe me. And I think this is happening right under our eyes now.
Yeah.
But we'll come to that later.
We'll come to that later. I saw the other day on the media that they had one of these ISIS men chopping off the head of a 13-year-old boy because he didn't come to the Friday night prayers at the right time. There's the sword.
That's exactly what Yahweh says in his other prophet, but we'll come to that later.
Yeah.
You know? And then in Amos 8:11, you know, it comes to our day, right? That there is a famine of the hearing of the word of Yahweh. Amos 8:11.
Behold, the days come, says Yahweh Elohim, I will send a famine in the land, not a famine of bread or a thirst for water, but of hearing the words of Yahweh.
We are definitely in that famine. There is no absolute.
So you can have the word of Yahweh, but you can't hear it.
Can't hear it.
No. It doesn't get in.
And I talk to people, and I talk to people who I love very dearly, but they don't hear. Absolutely don't hear. They have Bibles all around in their house. They go all over the place, but they don't hear the word of Yahweh.
And they shall wander from sea to sea, from the north to the east, and shall run to and fro to seek the word of Yahweh, and shall not find it. You see, it ties up with their thing. Give us a husbandman. In fact, the one that they will receive is not going to be Yahweh. You know, Yeshua said, you will receive another who comes. I come in the name of Yahweh, but there's another coming in his own name, and him you will receive.
Yeah. And they are receiving him.
Yeah.
They are standing up by the millions. They
the Pope said this, and he's good, and he's bringing peace to the land.
Yeah.
You know, that's all. You know.
Because he says, you know, you can be what you think. Right? It's exactly what Satan said to Adam and Eve, you know? No, you will not surely die. Right? But if you do this, you will be as God.
I find it very interesting if you listen to his collection of words, because people come to him and say, what about this and that, and you know, what about all these moral issues? And his comment was, who am I to judge? You see, like some of the conservative Catholics were absolutely stung by that in terms of what is biblical marriage. Who am I to judge, you see? And yet on the other hand, he'll come along and say those who are scripturalists and go by the scriptures,
the sword,
they are mentally ill and they are not Christians.
That's right.
Who am I to judge?
And we will deal with them.
Yeah.
As he dealt with them in the programs and what have you.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. So then we come to, chapter 9. And there Israel finds itself into exile. Verse 4. Though they are driven into exile by their enemies, there I will command the sword to slay them. Right. This is tough stuff, mate. This puts, But here is the hope in verse 8. Surely the eyes of the sovereign Yahweh are on the sinful kingdom, and I will destroy it from the face of the earth. Yet I will not totally destroy the house of Jacob, declares Yahweh. For I will give the command, and I will shake the house of Israel among all the nations, as grain is shaken in a sheaf, and not a pebble will reach the ground. All. Now this is very important. Everybody must underline this verse, which is verse 10 of chapter 9 of Amos. All the sinners amongst my people, all the sinners amongst my people will die by the sword. All those who say disaster will not overtake or meet us,
or the evil shall not overtake or prevent us. In other words, Yahweh is not going to judge us.
No. Because we're Jewish. We have an automatic right to the age to come.
Yeah.
Or we have Jesus, but we can do anything we want. We can go to the mosque and
we must make our own redemption back to Israel, and our own unity talks and ecumenicalism without Yeshua.
The law's passed away, so we don't need all this.
Yeah. I looked at this convention that you see on the web advertised, this B'nai, what do they call it? B'nai Ephraim or
B'nai? No, B'nai Joseph.
Ephraim. Yeah. And you go there and you look at this, and they're making their own unity talks with the whole thing of returning to the land, because this is their theology of their redemption. And there's no mention of whoever is leading it. You don't know who it is. There's no proclamation of Yeshua whatsoever.
No,
there's nothing of Yeshua in this thing at all.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. And it's all based on how we understand, how they understand, redemption will be fulfilled. And we mustn't get involved in them. It says, don't do these kind of things. Yeshua is going to do them all. Otherwise, you just pray for the mercy to be forgiven of our sins. Get ourselves time to get right, you know?
Yeah.
It must be a last generation, because when it comes to the point that the fair virgins and the young men faint for thirst, the thirst is the blessing of Yahweh, right? The fullness of the Spirit, and you can imagine all your thirst is filled, whatever. These are the young people that are fainting. They don't see the future. I really got to pray for these young people, because it's much easier for you and I in our age, and most of the people who listen to us, to discuss the things of the last days, because we're not 25 years of age and trying to look ahead at what the future is going to bring. And these people faint for fear, because what future is there? Unless our faith, we've walked, we've held on to Yeshua, and we've had to learn the hard way. But the young people, we really have to pray for them, that Yahweh has mercy on the young people of the household of faith, because they need to have that fullness of the Spirit that will bring them through, and the vision that comes, that of the redemption that's coming, so that they'll be strong in this day.
Yep.
But you can understand, it's another sign that it is the last generation.
Yeah, and then, in verse 11 of chapter 9, when you see Damascus being in a heap of rubble, when you see the people of Aram or of Syria being exiled, you know, 1.7 million sitting in Jordan, you know, Gaza in a mess and all these things happening, right? It says, in that day.
Are you, chapter and verse, where are you?
9:11.
Chapter 9, Amos 9:11.
In that day I will restore David's fallen tent. I will prepare its broken places and restore its ruins and build it as it used to be, so that they may possess the remnant of Adam and all the nations that bear my name, declares Yahweh. This is the thing that I will do. The days are coming, declares Yahweh, when the reaper will be overtaken by the plowman and the planter by one treading the grapes. New wine will drop from the mountain and flow from the hills. I will bring back my exiled people Israel. They will rebuild the ruined cities and live in them. They will plant vineyards and drink the wine. They will make gardens and eat the fruit. I will plant Israel in their own land, never again to be uprooted from the land that I have given them, says Yahweh, your Elohim.
And this is yet to come.
Yeah.
You know, according to Messianic Judaism, this has already been fulfilled at the time of Yeshua.
Yeah.
That's what they claim.
Yeah. Yeah.
But it's not possible, because only Judah was there in the time of Yeshua. We know historically only Judah was there. That's why Yeshua went to Galilee, to Samaria, because of the whole thing of finding the lost sheep of the house of Israel. So this prophecy was never fulfilled in the time of the restoration of Judah coming back from Babylon.
No, because I think it is in the book of John, one of the Gospels, where he says, I'm going to go to a place where you cannot go.
Yeah.
And then they said amongst themselves, where will he go? Is he going to go amongst the exiles, you know, in the nations? So they then knew that the exiles were still in the nations.
We're still in the nations.
James is writing to all the exiles in
greetings
the
to the lost
yeah,
house
and so
of
on,
Israel.
And so on, you know?
Yes. And it wasn't fulfilled in the 1948 either.
No.
Because if it was fulfilled, all the people that James is writing to, the apostle James is writing to, would be coming. And they, what happened was Judah got restored and they're anti-Yeshua and they wouldn't allow anybody else to come back.
Well, the biggest proof of the whole thing is that, have you seen Yeshua, right, with his angelic host, bringing back a remnant of Israelites from all the corners of the world?
No.
You know? That's
what I have seen is the rabbinics go finding people who keep their religion and then they say, aha, this is Israel, we bring them back.
Right. But the scripture says, when you repent in the exile.
Yes.
When you repent in the nations where I have scattered you.
Yes.
Then
I
will regather you.
Not religious tradition. Not the Pope. Not any human agency.
Not well-meaning Christians.
I will do it.
Not well-meaning Christians.
Which I believe, as we've discussed before, when you follow Yeshua's teachings, he says how he's going to do it. He will send his angels. So the issue is that there will be angelic messengers that will go dispatched to bring his remnant elect back, exactly as we saw a picture of it in Lot being brought out by angelic messengers in the time of great judgment, you see. So, you know, we haven't seen this fulfilled. We have not seen the scripture fulfilled.
Absolutely not.
No.
No.
Because if it was restored, we would have the Yeshua's Torah, because Yeshua is the son of Yahweh. It's not going to go back to the Judah restoring rabbinicalism in Jerusalem.
Now, we see that in Acts chapter 15, this same scripture comes up, which is after, you know, the disciples have been charged with this great commission. They must go out in the nations, right?
Mm-hmm.
They must go through all the cities of Israel, right? And when they have gone through all the cities of Israel, then Messiah will come back. Acts chapter 15 gives us confirmation of all this. Acts chapter 15, verse 14. Simon has described to us how Elohim at first showed his concern by taking from the nations a people for himself. The word of the prophets are in agreement with this, as it is written. After this, I will return and rebuild David's fallen tent.
Mm.
Now, you must go in the nations and find them. I will bring them back.
And it's the ones who have found and follow Yeshua.
That's very
clear in the apostolic testimony.
They are Abraham's seed.
Yeah.
And therefore they are heirs to this promise.
So this prophecy of has not happened.
No.
Of
Amos 9.
Amos 9. So I think it's good to fitting that we just read the confession, the prophetic word in Leviticus 26 of Moses to conclude, because the issue is one of intercession.
Mm-hmm.
And the intercession is that Jacob is very, very thin, and we are going to a very dark time, and we see it unfolding around us. And as you say, a lot of things that we're seeing in the media of what's happening in the Western countries and in the Middle East and so on, we don't get much about what's happening elsewhere, is actually appearing in the prophet Amos.
Yeah, but it's going to get clearer and clearer and clearer as we go through these other prophets.
Yeah. And there's going to be this famine for the word. And unless people go back to their root, seek the ancient path under the authority of Yeshua, they're going to find more and more famine, not more and more. This is a filling of their thirst. And verse 40 of Leviticus 26, Moses said, "If they shall confess their iniquity and the iniquity of their fathers with their trespass, which they trespass against me, and that also they have walked contrary to me, and that I've also walked contrary to them, and have brought them into the land of their enemies, if then their uncircumcised hearts be humbled, and they then accept of the punishment of their iniquity, then will I remember my covenant with Jacob, and also my covenant with Isaac, and also my covenant with Abraham will I remember, and I will remember their land."
That's
so
it.
That's what it's about. That's the confession. I believe we need to confess that, that in this day, our generation is to make this confession. It's quite a privilege on behalf of Jacob.
Absolutely.
The corollary of that is to read Daniel 9.
Yeah.
And there he makes a full confession of the same thing.
Nehemiah does the same.
Nehemiah, about the redemption in the last days.
Yeah.
That far be it from Yahweh, like Abraham made the same confession, that even one of the righteous would be destroyed in these cities. He gets down to 10, but Yahweh gets down to 1. He brought out 3. If there are even 10 righteous, I would not do it. So the issue is to be intercessors for the house of Jacob, according to what Yahweh is calling us to pray, not what we want to make up and pray.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So maybe for the next tape that we will make, people can read the book of Obadiah. And in conjunction with the book of Obadiah, read Ezekiel 35 and 36 in relation to the judgment of Edom or Esau. And this will happen before the millennial kingdom commences, because after Edom has been judged, the land that Edom possesses is allocated to the exiles who return.
That's fascinating.
Yeah, it's very fascinating.
Yeah. Well, we thank you, and we just hope this was a blessing to you, and we will meet you again when we get the next discussion done.
Sure will.
Cheers.